In the Gospel, Jesus teaches us a couple of very important lessons. And he also takes and dispels a couple of taboos that were part of his society. Now, a taboo is proscribed by society as improper or unacceptable. And so, in this gospel passage, Jesus breaks three of those taboos. The synagogue official comes to him, and he asks him to come and to lay his hands on his child so she will get well. And they start out on a journey. Now, the synagogue official is a very important person. But in the midst of this journey, this woman comes up behind Jesus and touches him. He feels the power go out, and because a woman has touched him, who is unclean, he is now unclean. But that doesn't seem to bother him, because he wants to know who this person is. And so, fearfully, she comes forward, and she makes her presence known and explains to him the situation. And he says to her, "Daughter," he calls her by a significant name, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." What she came to find out in that experience was she really didn't need to be afraid the first time to go to him. She could have come to him and he would have turned to her and he would have welcomed his arms to embrace her and to heal her and meet her needs. So now the journey continues, which is truly should never have happened. It should have been one straight journey to Jairus' house. So the journey continues and they get there, and of course there's all that commotion going on, and he says the child is not dead, she's asleep. And he goes in and he touches her, again, touching a woman and one who's died. That would have made him ritually impure, but he already is. So he doesn't hesitate. And he takes her and he says, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." She gets up and she walks around. And then he says, "Keep this quiet." Like that's going to happen. Little girl comes back from the dead, and you think no one is going to know this? And then he says to her very practically, "We'll give her something to eat." So the three taboos that Jesus has just thrown aside, because he is the God of healing, he is the God of life, and so nothing will stand in his way when he can help others be healed and embrace that life. So both of the stories illustrate for us the power that Jesus has over sickness and death. And he lovingly reaches out to those two women who in that society were not highly valued. Women and children did not have any value in that society. And so his kindness and his generosity know no bounds. There's no limits to the kindness and the generosity of God. Now, if God is our model in Jesus, then what does that say about us? It seems to me that we should be able to respond in kind. We should be that same spirit of kindness and healing and life and generosity to those people who are searching for it. Whether they come up to us, or whether someone asks of us. In our society today, we have a lot of healing needing to be done, and reaching out to people who are in need, who are in poverty, who are suffering. And so, if it's not going to begin with us, where then will it begin? And it takes each one of us understanding what those gifts are that God has given to us, to look for those experiences and opportunities to go out and to share them with others. Jesus sets the example. Now, in our society, are there taboos? Well, I think there used to be. But for me, I question that now, because the ones that I thought were firm, that were valued, that were a part of everyone's life, now seem to have been downplayed or ignored or undervalued. What are those? Lying, cheating, stealing, greed, domestic violence, hate crimes, killing. This is all commonplace. You open the newspaper, what are you faced with? You go on the internet, what do you read? Story after story, all throughout the country, that points to these taboos that are now so commonplace. And I think at some point, the temptation that we experience is we become desensitized. We look at it and we go, well, there's nothing I can do about it. Well, maybe not as one person, but when two people come together, God is present. When three people and four and five in a church community, things begin to change. Things begin to change, and they can change for the better. And where there is healing and suffering, maybe we have some of the means to meet the needs of those people. Honesty, truth, service to others are now the exception rather than the norm. The exception. You find them, they're there, but they're certainly not exposed and as freely present in our society as I think they once were. God, faith, religion, oh, swept that under the rug. No one wants to give credence to those topics. You want to talk about those? Well, that might mean a commitment. Might mean you have to live something that you say you believe in. So what's easier? Don't talk about it. And then you don't have to worry about it. And I think these are the topics that they have been fading away in many parts of our world. So I'm totally grateful that you are here today, because coming together to make that commitment and to worship in faith is a strong example of what's needed in our society. All around the world, and I don't know if you've had the opportunity to travel, but you go into churches in many countries throughout Europe, and that is, if you can get into the churches, some of them have the doors chained and locked, but if you can get into the churches, it's like a museum on Sunday. There's hardly anyone there to live out that gift of faith that's been given to them. We have a responsibility, my friends, to live that out and to share that and to bring it to the attention of others. Jesus brought life and healing to his society. And perhaps he can do the same for ours if we let him. I'm going to leave you with that thought. If we let him, perhaps he will do for us as he did for his own. Because really, we are his own.